Let us just stand and declare the word of the Lord. This is the word of God. We live by the word. We die by the word. This is the word of God. We live by the word. We die by the word. This is the word of God. We live by the word. We die by the word. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. We've been looking at the 17 works of the flesh. And when I started looking at it, I thought this is something I would be able to just run through and it would be over and done with. But I realized that there is so many things in these 17 works of the flesh that we, as people of God, as the Bible says, walk in the Spirit so we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And the verse that we're using, or the scripture that we're using, is Galatians 5, and we're in verse 19 to 21. We're in that those verses right now, looking at the 17 works of the flesh that will hinder you. And I want us to understand this, and I want to get it in our spirit. Because the Bible, and I say, until we get it and understand this, the Bible is not for the unsaved. The Bible is for us, it is our constitution. And everything in here, we got to read it, and the Bible says, Paul said, study to show yourself approved rightly, dividing the word of what? Truth. Amen. So if we don't know the truth in the word of God and know it correctly, because that's why he said, walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time. Walk circumspectly. It means to walk accurately. To walk the way the Bible says you should walk. It's not a mind thing. It's not, I think so, I feel so. That's not what it is. You've got to be accurate.
Glory.
We cannot just do it. That's why the Bible says we come to God and we have vain imagination. He don't want us to have vain imagination. He wants us to walk circumspectly, perfectly, accurately, according to the teaching of Jesus Christ and the apostles, not according to Moses, not according to the prophets, according to Jesus Christ and his apostles. Because that's who we're following. That's why it is the New Testament church of the living God.
Hallelujah.
Walk circumspectly, not as fool, redeeming the time, because we're living in evil days. There's false doctrines out there.
Amen.
And it's destroying the body of Christ. The Bible speaks of wolves and sheep clothing. We got to guard our minds. And we got to understand scriptures. We need to allow ourselves to be led by the Spirit of God. Not my mind's theology, but by the Spirit of God. Because the Bible says the natural man will not understand the word of God. And many of us don't even want the Spirit. Amen. And everything must be spiritually discerned.
Yes.
So we looked at idolatry last week, and we understand that anything that you place in your life,
hallelujah,
that you put more worth on, that's idolatry. So if you put your wife before God, it is idolatry. Put your children before God, it is idolatry. You put your work before God, it's idolatry. You put your cars before God, it's idolatry. You put your houses and everything you possess, and even the things that you think in your mind before God, it's idolatry. So we understand as people of God that we're going to use our time and everything that we have, we're going to use it wisely, because if our time that we have and that is allotted to us, we can use that in the wrong way. So let us redeem our times and start using our time well. And start doing the things that we are to do and acknowledge the things that we are to do if we want to be spiritual beings. Like I said, we're spiritual beings in a herd suit.
That's right.
So we got to live the spirit life. And those that are led by the Spirit, they are sons and daughters of God.
Amen.
So let our lives be led by the Spirit so that we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So whatever turn our attention away from God, or whatever you place before Him, is idolatry. What it is in your life today that you place before God? What it is that you'd rather to leave, to go and do instead of spend some time in the Word of God? What it is that you enjoy doing more than serving God. Because any of these things that as you place more value on become an idol. So you see, many of us say we're not idol worshippers because we're not bowing down to no statues. But you're bowing down to your houses, you're bowing down to your wives, you're bowing down to your children, you're not literally doing it, but you're doing it in your mind because you place these things at more value than God. So you want to create, you want to worship what is created and not the Creator. See? So we must spend more time worshiping the Creator than the things that He has blessed us with.
Amen.
He created it for us to have, to use, and to enjoy, but not to worship.
Amen.
So your wife is to enjoy and have everything good with, and husband, but not to worship. Your job is to give you food for your family, but not to worship. The house to live in, but not to worship. The car to move you around, but not to worship. Many of us would not go to work. They can't go to work because they don't go to church because the car is dirty. They're running too late for church than to and go wash their cars. It's more important that the car is clean than get to the house of God on time. It's more important that the food is cooked then get to the house of God and time to worship the King.
Hallelujah.
Many of us rather to go for the double time than spend the time in the house of the Lord. Idol worshiper. So let us look at witchcraft. So what is witchcraft? The practice of witchcraft or divination was a means of extracting information or guidance from pagan God. And you know, very early in my Christian walk, and I read the Bible, I realized that the devil is as real as God is. Ever since I saw that battle in Egypt with Pharaoh and Moses, it tells me that the devil has some power.
Yes, sir.
And the devil can do some things. But I recognize that, on the other hand,
yes,
that the power of God were more powerful.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
And that very first time I recognized, I said, the devil is real, but I thank God. More powerful. And then I understood in the Word of God that the Bible says that He created all these things for His own purpose. The evil for His own purpose. So he still controls it.
Yes. Glory to
God. The spirit of divination. Very dangerous spirit. It cannot do the same thing as a prophet would do. Speak for God, but instead, a spirit of divination speak for the devil. They conjure up their information from their source.
That's right. Glory.
And none of us in Jamaica, we got to the obeah man. Yeah. And you know, he tells me some stuff and are true. Yeah. Where did they get the information from? From demons.
Yes.
And many running around in the church of God today, they're possessed with demons. And you want, how did they know this? You got to know the difference.
That's right.
What the spirit of divination is and what the spirit of God is. It is a witchcraft spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
So the word describes the activity of Balaam, the soothsayer, our professional prophet, who was hired to curse Israel. Remember? A professional prophet was hired to go curse Israel. But because the power of God was more powerful, he could not curse Israel. He had to bless Israel.
Amen.
Glory. Oh, hallelujah. So as a body of Christ, you got to understand the spirit of witchcraft cannot do you nothing. You only succumb to it because it's so involved in yourselves.
Yes.
You believe it, so it affects you.
Yes.
But if you're rooted and grounded in the word of God, in the power of God, no witchcraft spirit,
amen,
no spell,
yes,
none of that stuff can affect you.
Glory.
Because you're walking in the power of a holy and righteous God. You are protected.
Amen.
That's not why. That's why not everybody tells the things I believe.
That's right.
Because I have a spirit in me that agree or disagree.
That's right. Glory. Glory. Glory.
You know, you can tell me as much as you want to tell me how much message you have to give me, but I have a spirit. That lives in me, that breaker.
Yes. Glory.
That can agree or disagree.
Yes.
And I don't have to say yes or no, but in my spirit, I know if you're speaking the truth or you're lying.
Amen. Glory.
I was in Houston, Texas. And I went to a meeting, a prophet called Moses from Africa. He called me up and he was prophesying over me. And he was prophesying truth. But sometimes you're from the truth and you think there's more and you want to conjure up some more. So I accepted the part of the prophecy, but then he called me back and started to say some more stuff. And my preacher said, that's a pit from the pit of hell. Don't even listen to that. So we got to be careful of witchcraft spirit. Hallelujah. So in Numbers 22 verse 7 and Numbers 23:23, in Joshua 13 verse 22, it is also described the woman at Endor who brought up the spirit of Samuel. You remember that?
That's right.
Yeah. The woman went and conjured up the spirit of Samuel. Why? Because Saul was looking for information. Because when God said no and put you off, you go trying to find some other source.
That's right. Glory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
So our occult practices, such as fortune telling, do we have some people that we can't go about the day without buying and reading our horoscopes? We have Christians that are doing that, isn't it? Witchcraft. But I don't. spells. I don't mix up potions. But your figure trying to find out your future outside the realms of God. All common, all, that's what practices their witchcraft. Because all of those common to the pagan world. And that's what they said in Deuteronomy 18, verses 11, 10 to 11. So today I have a question for you. Are Christians practicing witchcraft? Are Christians practicing witchcraft? Are we not practicing witchcraft? Well, I don't read tarot cards. Does that mean that you're not casting spell? You don't mix up portions? You don't cast spell? Well, the Bible talks about all these things. So consider what the Bible said about witchcraft. It may surprise you to learn that the word called witchcraft is not always one and the same as what the Bible calls witchcraft. For example, when you think of witchcraft, you're probably thinking of black magic or conjuring the dead. Is that what we're thinking? Is that what we think? And the Bible said, all these things are abomination. And the Bible covers it all. But witchcraft is not always so mysterious indeed, but rebellion, word curses, and the works of the flesh also fall in the realms of witchcraft. So wherever you define it, to practicing witchcraft is a serious, serious sin, and more Christians are expert. I said, many Christians are expert at sorcery than we even realize. You remember Saul? The witchcraft of rebellion. Many of us Christians, we have the spirit of rebellion, which is a witchcraft spirit. God said to Saul, I want you to go and I want you to kill all the Midianites. Kill everything. Leave nothing alive. Take nothing back. But what did Saul do? He best of everything, livestock, and even brought the king back. Hagar, he brought the king back. And when things are happening and Samuel show up, that actually you can find it in 1 Samuel 15, verse 1 to 19, and also Samuel 15 to 22. So Saul was so stubborn that even after he did all this and he found out Saul, someone went to him and said, guess what? What you did, you disobeyed God.
Hallelujah.
And he said, oh, I did not. I did everything that he said I should do. But I wanted to bring all this back, give back lambs and all that, because I wanted to do what? I want to make sacrifice. And what did Jesus say? The God just said, obedience is better than sacrifice and hearken unto the fat of ram. So that response, we find one way that Christians are practicing that sin is the rebellion of witchcraft. True, rebellion that arises when the fear of man is greater than the fear of God. You see, when God sends you out to do something, and you start fear man, and does not do what God asks you to do, there is a spirit of rebellion, and it That's what Paul says. He feared the people. And because he feared the people, he disobeyed God. Oh, okay. We don't believe that. All right. This is what he said in Samuel chapter 15, verse 23 to 24. For rebellion is as the sin of
witchcraft
and stubbornness.
Because what? Rebellion
is as the sin of witchcraft.
Is as the what?
Sin of witchcraft.
Of witchcraft. And stubbornness is as iniquity of idolatry, because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected thee from being king. And so to them to Samuel, I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord, thy words, because I fear the people and obey their voices. So instead of we fear God and do what God asks us to do, we fear man instead, and the spirit of rebellion against God, it is a witchcraft spirit. Are we doing that today? Is the church guilty of that spirit? God placed the church in the world that the world should see us as the light. But we succumb to the things of the world instead of fearing God and do what God says. And the purpose of the church in the communities and in the world today is to reach out and impact lives. But we allow in the world to impact us. It's a spirit of witchcraft that is on the church. We fear man. We're okay inside the building. We can say whatever we want in the building, but when we go outside of the building, our mouth is shut. We can't even talk about God because the fear is upon us. A spirit of witchcraft. The church is bewitching more people than we think. Because we need to obey the voice of God and be a Christ-centered church and not a man's church. Go out and impact the lives of people. And Father Destroyer did not learn his lesson. He continued disobeying God, and eventually what? He lost his kingdom. Why? The fear of man was rooted in his rebellion. The fear of man was rooted in his rebellion, but rebellion grows from many roots. So I'm going to encourage you today to get rid of witchcraft, spirit, all of you. You got to search your lives and see what God is saying to you and how you're living your life. Are you living in obedience to Christ? Are you living it according to the way you want to live because you fear people? You fear man. Oh my God. And when you find it, I'm asking you to pluck it out. Dig it out from the root. When we do that, our lives will not be the same. The church of the living God today has been affected by the witchcraft spirit because we are not doing what God says we should be doing. What about the word curse? The witchcraft spirit our words casting spells on our children. Through our words that we speak over them. Another spirit. That spirit of Jezebel. That spirit that the body of Christ needs to get rid of. We know about Jezebel in 2 Kings 9, 22. The spirit of sedition that works to escort believers into immorality and adultery. And that's what it says in Revelation 22, 2 verse 20. Notwithstanding, I have a few things. This is what he says. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou suffereth that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a what? A prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servant to commit fornication and to eating, sacrifice unto idols. The spirit is used with witchcraft against his enemy. Now, listen to this now. You remember what happened to Elijah? A man that was so powerful in God. And what was he doing? He was calling down fire. If I'm a man of God, burn up these 50. And the fire will come from heaven and consume them. If I'm a man of God, send fire down and burn these 50. Fire came down, burned them. The next set were coming, they crawl on their knees to the man of God and begging for their lives.
That's right. That's right. Glory.
But Jezebel, the prophetess, the witch doctor, send a word. By tomorrow, this time, we will feed your flesh to the dogs. What happened? That word was so powerful that it put fear into the man of God. That the man run to the God and said, God, I want you to kill me. Take my life before Jezebel can't catch up with me. That word was so powerful, it drives fear. Witchcraft spirit. Oh, hallelujah. And that's what that was rooted in rebellion. Oh, hallelujah. Jezebel, witchcraft spirit is rooted in rebellion, but the type of witchcraft in this verse refers to incarnation and spell. So that word that he sent, it was such a powerful spell. That word went out and it hit Elijah and he ran.
That's right.
Fear overtook him. We gotta be careful, church. So Jezebel released a word against Elisha that carried a spirit of fear when she sent him the message. And we say, word is not powerful. Huh? If we say word is not powerful, so let the gods do to me and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one by the morrow, by this time. 1 Kings 19:2. So in modern time, word curse aren't always so dramatic, right? When we speak negatively over one's life, do we? We're not so dramatic and say, you're going to die by tomorrow evening, or when we speak in negativity over our children, over your brothers, over your sisters. How about saying to your kids, you're going to be a thief, you're a thief, you're just like your father. How about that? You know, I know a lady in this city that said that to your son, you're just like your father. You're gonna end up just like he did. And you know that boy did everything he dad did? The last time he walked in this place and he put out his knife and cut a young guy's belly out and right on the floor, just like how his dad was. How are we casting spell? Oh, are we being witchcraft, the spirit of witchcraft that's upon us, that we're using, and we're looking at our brothers and our sisters, and we're casting spells? How about, you see those two? Their marriage is not going to last. How about that spirit? How about those two? Oh, is she? She cannot hold on to that job. How about that spirit? anointed mouth that we are using to sing God, supposed to be singing God and bring glory to God, or are we using to cast spells on our brothers and our sisters? You see him? He's not going to mount up to nothing. What about that? You see him? In body, you see it? Really? The environment and the words that we speak over our children is life.
Yes, sir.
You know the Wesleyan church? That woman had her children, and the foundation of the Wesleyan church came from a whole woman who had her kids who every morning she would pray for her children and send them off to school. And every day before they come out in the house, they would just meet them at the door and she would lay hands on them.
That's right.
Before they come to the house. Because whatever spirit that will come in, she makes sure it's gone. Get rid of it before they enter into your house.
Hallelujah.
And today, the Wesleyan church around the world came out of that home. What are we doing? Casting spells on our children, our brothers and sisters in the church. You go to the doctor, and the doctor says, oh, you only have X amount of time to live. You said, okay, and you go home and you're going to. You accept it. You don't even go back and say, God, I know who you are. You are my physician. And I am not saying it's final until you say it is final. Accept it and roll over. Agree with the enemy and give him power over you through the mouth. I remember going to my doctor, and I went to the doctor and I had a Ouija in my stomach. You know, I got a cold. I went there for something. He wanted to know my family history. Is anybody in your family has asthma? I said, yeah, I believe my dad has asthma. He said, I believe that's what you have. And I said, I send that back to pit of hell. I have no asthma. I don't want no puffer. Many of us are walking with things that God did not give us. People speak in their life and we believe it. Today, I still have no asthma. I don't need no puffer. If I had succumbed to what he said, I would have gone out. And I would start buying puffer, and I would start puffing, and I would be living on puffer. But I said, not because my dad had it. I don't have to have it. I'd have it. And it's not mine. God did not give it to me. I don't want it. The words, the power of death and life is in the what?
Tongue.
Proverbs 18, verse 21. If you are inadvertently or purposely releasing witchcraft over people with the words of your mouth, repent.
Hallelujah.
And get your mouth back in line.
Glory.
Church of God.
Amen.
Get your mouth back
in line.
And speak life and not death. Jesus said, I'll come to give life and life more abundantly. Don't speak death over your brother and your sister. It is a witchcraft spirit. Speak life. Believe with them for healing. Believe with them that their marriage will work. Believe that your children will be king, good children. Believe with them. Don't curse them. I know she wasn't going to make it, you know. If you only baptized baptized because him say so and so baptized. We know it's not going to make it. Stop it. Speak life.
Yes, sir.
Whatever method God used to bring somebody, trust God that you bring them. We're going to support them and we're going to speak life into them. We're going to nurture them the best way we know how.
Amen.
Glory. The body of Christ is busy with their witchcraft spirit, speaking death instead of life. The Bible says, we're not supposed to be ministers of death. Should be ministers of life. I was in Jamaica in a church, one of our church convention, and that's why I'm very careful of who come into my house that God has put me in to shepherd, to be shepherd over his people. I be careful of who comes in the house, because I was in Jamaica in this house, and a brother came in and he was preaching. And when he believed he wasn't reaching the people, he was telling people how many people are going to die in the community. And I stood up and I said, that will never happen. Speak life. God don't call us to speak death. He's casting a spell on the community that how many young man's going to die. And what happened in the community that they go, you speak, and next day he's getting a phone call. I said, it's not going to happen here.
Amen. Glory.
Nobody, no young man going to die in that community. Speak life. Yes, sir. I was getting angry when you're preaching and nobody's coming. But you don't do the drawing.
That's right.
You just do the preaching.
Amen.
And trust God for the drawing.
That's
you want to be gods. So you want to preach and people run and come and bow. When people are not running and bowing, you figure well then you're not doing a good job.
Right.
Speak. And God will do the word. The word of God. Sharper. And the two-edged sword. Pierce the bone into the marrows.
Hallelujah.
Preach the word and leave the consequence of God.
Amen.
He will do the drawing.
That's right.
Let's be careful, church, of what we're doing. Many of us are really expert at being a witch. And we're looking at Wicca and all these witches. You know, there's a religion, a witch out there. A witch religion. You know? And we're looking at everybody else and we're not even looking at us. And the Bible says we have to be careful to guard the things that come out of our mouths. It's a tongue, it's a ruling, unruly member. It's can't easily tamed. You can only tame through the word of God. Nothing else can tame the tongue. And the only way it can be tamed, you gotta fill the word of God in you, that even though the tongue will get unruly, it cannot be unruly because the word of God control it.
Hallelujah.
So that's why it's important for you to read the word.
Amen.
And study the word of God.
Praise
because
God.
When you speak, it's supposed to only good things want to come out of it because it's what's on the inside come and the outside. If there's nothing in there, nothing going to come out.
Sure.
So if there's nothing in there good, nothing good going to come out. We got to make sure that we're putting in the right stuff so that what comes out will bring life to the people. We're not supposed to minister in debt. We're supposed to minister in life. God's grace be with you. God caused his face to shine upon you and give you peace.